So thank you very much, Arturo. You described me as omnivorous. I was sitting in his office, which had a range of books and topics. So I would say he's the true omnivore in the room, but I would certainly say, and I am delighted to be here and delighted to be in CEP in particular, and happy to represent the University of Chicago and the Harris School. So I'm going to follow Sergio's lead. We have too many slides. And in fact, some of the slides I will draw on come from Sergio and our joint work with on this topic. So let me just describe what the issue is. And in fact, in some sense, Arturo has done a very good job in describing it, so we could stop and I could just say, well, any questions? Because it's the short summary of it, and I do want to describe it. But let me give you a few outlines, and I will skip through some of the slides because it is late and I don't want to go over too much over time anyway. So what I want to talk about is achievement tests, and I realize that in some sense this might be interpreted as a dissenting note, in the sense that there is a use and reliance, critically, in education and education policy evaluation on tests and test scores to screen, to sort, and to monitor the success of schools and society. So we know, for example, Chile has recently been delighted that its PISA test scores went up, and the No Child Left Behind score tests have been discussed. There are many other tests, NAEP, and I want to talk about a particular test called the General Educational Development Test, not because it's of great interest or general interest, but there's some lessons from it. So the test itself isn't of interest, but it has some very important general interest, and I think what I want to talk about is what these tests miss and what they and the point is that what they miss is actually quite important. And as has already been said by several speakers, actually, you were describing this before, Marco, but the missing aspect of personality traits, which I think are actually very important. Now, these traits are sometimes called soft skills, and in fact, there are also other names for these skills, like character and so forth. And so there are a number of aspects that this terminology includes. So it includes things like perseverance, conscientiousness, motivation, and willful planning. And what I want to show you is some evidence, and there's a lot of accumulating evidence, that these are important skills. It's not to say that cognition and other aspects of tests or other aspects of schooling and other aspects of human behavior aren't important. But I want to show you, at least give you some examples from American public policy, that ignoring these traits is a dangerous thing to do. And it can lead to very costly mistakes. And I want to show you what a few of those have been in American public policy. So I want to show you, in particular, by a study of an exam called the GED, the General Educational Degree. It's an achievement test that is given in the United States. I don't know if there's one in Chile. I don't think there is. But there is in Brazil, actually, a version of this, and certainly in Canada and other countries. It's a test that's given to people who are dropouts from secondary school, but they can take the test and certify that they're the equivalents of high school graduates. So you take the test and you can cert. And so it's used in many different parts of the world. And the GED has been very successful in the American case. I'll just give you an example. This is a graph that shows that starting around, if you go back to 1955, which is the left-hand side of that graph, I guess I can use the pointer here, and you go over here, what you can actually see, whoops, is that, so on the left-hand side, the ordinate is actually showing you the percent of GEDs. GED is a percent of all high school credentials issued in the United States. And it started around 1960 at a very low level. And it reached a peak of around 2000, where about almost one out of every five high school credentials issued was a GED. It fell starting around 2001 because they made the test a little harder. But it's a major factor still in American education. It's about 12% of all American students' credentials issued each year are to these GEDs. So these are people who drop out of school, they take a test, and the test certifies they're the equivalents of high school graduates. And what I want to argue is the lessons that one learns from this program are very broad, and I think they apply to many countries. So this is a test that's quantitatively important in the United States. So what are these lessons I want you to extract? First of all, it's kind of an obvious point, but it's one that gets missed a lot in developments and sort of evaluation. So in the nitty-gritty, and I have great respect for the Chicago Schools Project, so I'm not in any sense criticizing it, but when you get down to measurement, there are very tough questions that come. But I would try to sound this dissenting note or supplementing note that there are aspects of that more than academic achievements required for success in life, and that this trait, personality, can be measured. And in fact, these can be fostered. So it's something that we can actually do, and something that is actually a tool of social policy that supplements the kind of normal focus on cognitive traits. So interventions that promote these traits, which are called sometimes called character traits, are relatively unexplored. They're beginning to be explored in American public policy, and even the Chicago Public Schools working on things like tools of the mind. I'll talk briefly about that intervention. But there are also other lessons, and this is what I want to say, and this is the dissenting note, maybe not a good follow-up from the previous session, but I'll still say that there's a sense in which the movements for accountability in education can sometimes create perverse incentives, and we've seen this in the United States. And so what I want to argue is that the reliance on tests not only doesn't capture the full dimension of performance of human beings, but it actually, in many cases, leads to perverse incentives. And I want to talk a little bit about No Child Left Behind and the experience with No Child Left Behind. And so what I want to argue is that uncritical reliance on these tests as measures of school outcomes can actually be dangerous social policy. So, again, drawing on some of the work with Sergio, which I'll summarize, but I'm also happy to stop with just making a few broad statements. So you can stop me almost at any time, because these are the claims I want to make, and then I will, as time permits, I'll try to establish these claims. But there's a wide array of outcomes that are causally affected by these soft skills. So we look at these, and there are some interventions that show this, but we know that when we look at a range of outcomes, smoking, health, teenage pregnancy, high school graduation, wages, criminal activity, welfare dependency, these so-called soft skills are very, very powerful. And when we look at their relative predictability, I mentioned the word causality, but also looking just at predictability, that in many cases these soft skills play a greater role in determining outcomes than do cognitive skills. And in fact, that was really partly what you were saying. Physical education in Brazil was actually personality skills. So then there's a question, if soft skills are so important, why have they been ignored for so long? And I think the view is that they're hard to measure. And that's been a view that's actually been maintained for more than a century and a half in American education. So many people still view these as very fuzzy concepts. I had about a year ago, I had a meeting with the mayor of New York, Bloomberg, and we were talking about exactly this concept about soft skills. And I said, well, you know, he said, it's very fuzzy, there's no way to measure it, and then I gave him a slideshow, some of which you'll see today. But I think it is the case that we do have better measurements of these skills, and it isn't the impossible task that it sometimes made to be. And I think another reason that's viewed is that soft skills are just too tenuous. They kind of lead to some kind of soft and fuzzy feeling. You have self-esteem or you so forth. And I want to argue, no, actually there's a lot of hard evidence on it. So let me just give you some idea of what this is. So there's a truism, and I think it's true, that achievement depends on many different traits. So we think about this. Nobody's going to really argue that. So we think broadly, just from our own personal experience, that achievement in different fields depends on bundles of these traits. And academic achievement is only one of those. So the great example that many American U.S. people like to draw on is that Thomas Edison was a person who was extremely brilliant. He created a lot of inventions. He's very well known for his clever work. But it's also well known that he was extremely hardworking. In fact, he would fall asleep at his laboratory at night. And he coined this phrase that in his own self-description, the genius was 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. And that's actually Albert Einstein said that too. I think Albert Einstein probably ripped off Thomas Edison, but I'm not sure who said it first. But then, taking another great mind, Woody Allen, basically made the summary that 80% of success is showing up. And there's some truth to that, just literally being there. So I think we know, and from common sense point of view, and so this is where I'm kind of appealing to your common sense, but also going to show you some hard evidence that supports the common sense. The different tasks require different skills. We look at leadership tasks, we look at performance, we look at drilling holes and making a pavement, producing various kinds of tasks that weight the physical, the mental, and the various aspects of self-control, self-discipline, and so forth. So what I would say is that we don't consider this as much as we should in American public policy, and I want to argue this should probably be remedied when we think about serious public policy approaches. So what's happened, at least in American education, I really don't know the state of play in Chilean education, for that matter, Brazilian education and so forth, that even though 150 years ago, if you looked at American educators and what they said was important, that schools are now expected to focus primarily on cognitive skills and cognition, and not to teach what's sometimes called character. And that school effectiveness is viewed more as measures of cognitive tests. And that the character education is viewed much more to be the province of the family and not the school. But that wasn't always the case. And yet I think, even if we think that the family really is the source of all of these character traits and really should not be taught in school and really nothing that we should do, we have to recognize when we look at many families in many countries around the world, Chile, the United States, Taiwan, many countries around the world, that the family is under great attack. If you look at measurements of stress and family stress, that really relying on the family is actually relying on an institution that itself is under attack. So somehow delegating this to an institution that itself is failing or has some troubles might in fact be just kind of passing the buck and not really understanding how we could do. So what I would argue is that we really need to look beyond this one-dimensional focus. So let me just give you a little bit of history. I promised one of the alums of the Department of Education at the University of Chicago to talk a little about the origins of testing. So even though I'm not an educational historian, I will give you a little bit of educational history, partly to emphasize the origins of testing and who created these tests, where they come from, and what the originators of almost every major test, whether it's the first achievement test, the IQ test, and various other tests in between, have always said. So everybody goes back in modern American education. I guess they go back to Benjamin Franklin, but actually or Thomas Jefferson, but actually practical terms, it's Horace Mann in the 1840s. Now, Horace Mann did a lot of things. He created the Common School movement and so forth, but he also introduced the standardized test. I don't know if people knew that, but he created the test. He was trying to evaluate the schools in Massachusetts. The instrument was crude, and he saw its limitations. But it's interesting to get a quote from Mann it was published in 1867. It was written in 1840. He was dead by 1867, by the way. So basically, this is what he said about the achievement test that he introduced. These were accountability tests. And if you read it yourself, he's basically saying, we're only measuring part of the person. And he warned that. But he said, I don't know how to do it any better. In fact, what he had was quite crude. And in fact, so if you go back over the history of testing in the 19th century, it really didn't catch on. And partly because the technology wasn't there. And then starting in at the end of the 19th century, the progressives basically got interested in trying to broaden the scope of education, and tests introduced, but not achievement tests, not what Horace Mann originally developed, but the IQ test emerged on the scene. And there the goal was essentially different from trying to measure schools. It was the idea we create the IQ test, we have a mechanism by which we filter students in, we can decide which students, because the idea was to broaden education, but it was also recognized that different students had different ability levels, and therefore we could track students. So the idea is the progressives actually introduced the idea of tracking, and certain progressives anyway were actually quite actively engaged in trying to screen misfits out, but it was a screening function. It wasn't really an accountability function. But it's interesting because the IQ test was basically taken from the French. So the Stanford-Binet test was originally invented by Alfred Binet. It was applied in the U.S. by Louis Terman. But it's very interesting to read what Binet wrote about this. It kind of echoes what Horace Mann was saying. So this is the IQ test now. He was trying to predict who succeeded and failed in schools. And what Binet says is basically very similar to what Mann was saying. That basically the success in school, which is what he was trying to predict, depends on a lot of other things besides what his IQ test was all about. So he was really talking about these soft skills. And this is going to be a recurrent theme. So anyway, a lot of people have talked about this. I will simply say that one person who's most associated with the concept of cognition über alles, to use a German term, this notion that is Arthur Jensen. But in his book, The G Factor, you know, everybody knows G is a measure of cognition. He writes in this passage, it's near the end of the book, it's true, but nonetheless it's a passage, that what are the chief personality traits which, interacting with G, of course, predict success? And he talks about conscientiousness. And that's a theme that runs throughout all of the literature, even by the most rabid devotee of IQ. Well, the trouble with IQ is not a very good measure, at least in its original conception about how to measure schools. Why? Because it was viewed, at least when it was introduced, as a fixed tree. Now, we're not sure that's true anymore, but that's another story. So what happened in the late 19th and early 20th century was that there was this movement, you've probably all heard of it, called Taylorism. Taylorism formalized an idea, and I would argue that Taylorism is still very much alive and well, in fact, very much alive and well in the educational accountability movement. But Taylorism, if you haven't heard of it before, was this gospel of scientific management to measure the productivity of the American factory. So there were time and motion studies and so forth. Now, at the University of Chicago, there was a leading important educator named Bobbitt. He plays an important role. And Bobbitt was a Taylorist. He actually was reading closely the work of Taylor. And he was trying to apply these principles. And this is his view about what education was all about. This is sort of around the time of John Dewey. Dewey had already left when he wrote this. But nonetheless, you'll notice what he talks about. He had a whole system about how you devise a curriculum to improve and create schools. But he didn't, and he thought, by the way, like other people, what was education doing? Well, he thought of it now in a Taylorist notion. It's a shaping process. It's like the manufacture of steel rails. But what are you doing now is you're shaping things more immaterial, namely personality traits as well as cognition. Somebody was shaping nonetheless. But Bobbitt lacked the tools. And so, again, since IQ was basically a fixed trait, you couldn't really use that. So a new concept was introduced, and it's really a 1920s concept that came after the introduction of IQ. Why am I going to this history? Because it's a very new thing. It's more recent than the airplane, actually, the achievement test. It's actually, the Model T, which came in 1908. And so what was general knowledge? Well, the concept of general knowledge was really created by these two major figures in American education. One is Ralph Tyler, who was at the University of Chicago. And by the way, the University of Chicago plays a very important role. And they created a concept of general knowledge. And it's this that is used, or various versions of this. So for example, the Iowa tests, so Lindquist was at Iowa as an example of this. The GED, which I'm going to talk a little about, the No Child Left Behind is still an outgrowth of this, and the NAEP tests, which are used to monitor. So basically, all of these tests were basically trying to capture the idea of what had been learned in school, but there were some general principles that we learned. So you're not specific courses, not specific facts, not even whether or not you knew physics or mathematics, but how could you sort of solve? So it was a very abstract concept, this idea of general knowledge, and it's still with us today, I think. And it's interesting to assess it. But again, I don't want to keep repeating the same story, but Tyler wrote heavily, I wrote strongly, I wrote frequently about these tests. And basically, he understood the importance of these soft skills and these emotional skills. And Tyler himself questioned the kind of test that he himself was developing. So Tyler himself developed the NAEP test. He developed, along with others, all of the modern achievement tests. So he is a great legend. But in each one of these tests, he often talked about the limitations of the test, that they didn't really build everything in. And he talked, actually, about a specific plan to make a broader inventory about what students learned. So why do I go on to all this? Well, because the GED, and in fact the achievement test, arose out of this whole notion of how to measure the success of schools, but in an abstract level. General knowledge that was acquired. Well, what was interesting about the GED was that after the First World War, when many American troops, when many American boys were drafted out of high school, there was an attempt to try to certify their experience. So at one time after the First World War, all soldiers who hadn't finished high school when they got into the Army were certified as high school equivalents. And that was viewed as a massive failure by the 1920s. They simply didn't have the skills. We had a larger draft in the Second World War, and we had to do something about the veterans, but how would you certify them? Well, the Iowa test, the achievement test, had been developed, and the GED had been perfected. So the GED is just an achievement test that came of this sort. Now, what was interesting about it is that the GED was going to be used to see whether soldiers, many of whom had been drafted out of high school before they finished, were able to certify themselves as the equivalents and maybe go on to college, participate in the GI Bill, or just be assimilated into a larger society. But they didn't want to have this uncritical reliance on just service. Implicit in this, though, was that a lot of traits that were associated with being in the Army for 2 or 3 years were more or less possessed by the degree holders. And so they took this test, which was basically an outgrowth of the of these achievement tests, the Iowa test. It really was a version of the Iowa test. And they gave it to soldiers. And the soldiers then were certified, and millions of students took it. But now in the 1950s, the test was broadened. The idea was, look, we have this device which can certify who's a good high school. And then it was, in the early years, there was some notion that this was a very successful test. But one key ingredient, soldiers, think of all the discipline, think of all the fact they stayed in school for so many years. That trait was assumed, and then was brought into the general population of high school dropouts. So by the late 50s and early 60s, you saw that graph that I had, the GED started, came in. So at the same time, there was this massive force towards egalitarianism, towards meritocracy. And so without getting further into the history, I would simply say that part of that growth that I showed you in terms of the test scores, in fact, this is the growth that I showed you a minute ago, that was the growth, was actually fueled by a number of developments in American social policy. And there are developments that you might want to take to heart in terms of Chilean policy. So in the 1960s, we had two major developments. In the Kennedy-Johnson administration, there was a huge emphasis on accountability. McNamara actually was probably the pioneer of this more than anybody. He did it in the Defense Department. So McNamara had been the whiz kid at Ford Motor. He was a Harvard MBA. He was interested in accountability. And he tried to apply those principles to the military. And the most obvious and the most widely used version was the body count. I don't know if anybody remembers the body count, but it was basically a measure of success. It's called kill ratio. How many Vietnamese died relative to an American who died? It was a measure of accountability. Not a particularly good measure, by the way, as you can see in retrospect. But then in the war on poverty and the war that came out, there was also a huge emphasis on evaluation. I think this is where modern evaluation really got started. Henry Aaron has written a book on this. But the Great Society basically started focusing, and a huge emphasis was in human capital policy. We're going to try to upgrade the skills of people. And that we're going to focus not only on upgrading the skills, but we wanted to find out what worked and what didn't work, so that people who were sitting at the table with McNamara could say, yes, we have our own version of the body count, we have our own measure, and in that case it was test scores, and there lying on the shelf were lots of tests. And also a measurement of how to address the problem, which was pervasive and still is pervasive in American society, of many dropouts, many high school dropouts, many disadvantaged people. And so the GED was actually a real measure of output. So if you believe a test score was measuring the success, who is a good student, who is a bad student, that basically you could say, okay, job training programs, this program, that program would be measuring these things. And so what happened was that America gradually became obsessed and preoccupied with tests. And what happened to accentuate this development was a report that came out about 30 years ago called Nation at Risk. And Nation at Risk basically talked about how America was failing. And the idea was we would succeed. We would succeed how? By essentially having achievement tests and by giving accountability. So then Governor Clinton and many others, the first Bush, and then the later, of course, Bush. And then, of course, accountability became extreme during the period of the Bush administration, the second Bush administration, when No Child Left Behind was put in. So here's a measure of how standardized tests. So the GED took off. So let me just give you, what is the GED? Let me just give you very briefly. This is an example of the questions from the sample GED test. What does it measure? Actually, it's claimed to be a calibration of people who are basically at 10th grade level, sometimes say 8th grade. The threshold has been increased, so the level of cognitive test. But this is an example of a difficult question, or an easy sample question, a difficult question. These are math questions, but they're math, reading, and other scores. You can decide for yourself how difficult that is, and whether or not it represents what high school education is all about, but this is like one of the five components on the GED test. So who are the GEDs? Well, the GEDs are basically people who are somewhere intermediate in terms of their family background between the dropouts who don't take the test and ordinary high school graduates. They are as smart as ordinary high school graduates, so they don't go on to college. So we have lots of measurements on these. We follow them from many different data sets. I'll just summarize one evidence at all. So this is, for example, a study that I did, we're doing actually now with Sergio, who previously presented. And this is a study, but there are many graphs of this type, and we have earlier graphs in a previous paper with Sergio as well. So this is for women, but you get basically the same pattern for men. So what you can see is three graphs there. I don't know if you can see them. I can show you here. This is a probability density, a frequency of occurrence of an event. And so on the left-hand score here, the low score is on the left side, a high score is on the right side. And so here you see high school, here you see high school dropouts having relatively low cognitive test scores as measured by, this is a measure of an achievement test, an ordinary achievement test. So we can measure the GEDs and calibrate them against some standard measure. In this case, it's called the Armed Forces Qualifying Test. And so what you see is that the GEDs, who are these dashed lines here, these more densely dashed lines, and the high school graduates, who are ordinary high school graduates who stay on for 4 years, in or 3 years in secondary school, have very similar abilities. So they're basically, and the same thing is true for males, a little bit of difference there, but generally the pattern is the GEDs are just as smart, measured by the usual way, as high school graduates. Yet they lack non-cognitive skills. And without getting into a lot of details, what we can show you is we have some measures of non-cognitive skills. And so we can, again, with the same kind of architecture, show for the females, when we look at the measure of these non-cognitive skills, and these are some of the same traits that you were talking about and came up in several different talks already, that in fact, the GEDs and the dropouts are indistinguishable in non-cognitive skills. And the same thing is true for males. A little bit of separation, but still, there's a difference. And now you ask, okay, this is an interesting experiment. You have a group of people who are just as smart, measured by an achievement test, as ordinary high school graduates, but they lack these non-cognitive skills, these perseverance, the ability to show up on time, and so forth. And then you can ask the question, how well do they do? So since I'm running a little low, running behind, I should probably just give you the verbal summary. But what we find is that, yes, GEDs do slightly better if you look at their wages. If you look at their earnings, they do a little bit better. But once you adjust for their ability, they either do about the same as high school dropouts or worse. So I say they do a little bit better. They do a little bit better than dropouts. They don't ever do as well as high school graduates, but they do a little bit better. But once you adjust for their higher ability, and you saw they were higher ability, they actually, in some studies, they actually do worse, but they certainly don't do any better. So what you're getting is a very sharp separation where some people have these cognitive skills and they lack these non-cognitive skills. So I'll skip these graphs. And if you look at the social performance of the GEDs, their behaviors are different. In fact, sometimes they're worse than dropouts. They have this persistent pattern that they drop out of everything. They drop out of school. Now, because, I mean, these are now the post-World War II GEDs, they drop out of everything. They drop out of army. They drop out of marriage. In fact, the U.S. Army, until recent times, quit taking GEDs. They got a little stressed trying to get troops for the Iraq War and the Afghanistan War, so they relaxed the standards. But the fact is that the GEDs don't perform. If you look at the Navy and the Air Force, they haven't taken GEDs. I gave a lecture at Annapolis a few years ago, and they said only under rare circumstances, like illness, would they take a GED. Why? Because they knew about the personality traits. So these questions of perseverance. Okay, so again, I'll skip the graphs. You could say, well, maybe, look, there's ability. Maybe this GED is serving a social function by signaling that some people are smart and not. That could be a social function. But we can actually measure these people's wages before and after they take the GED, at least the adult GEDs, and what we find is they actually earn no higher wages, they don't do any better. There's no signaling function. And so there's no evidence of any gain from this. And the same thing is true for the signaling function for immigrants. It might be, well, you get a Mexican immigrant coming to the United States with 6 or 7 years of schooling. That person may in fact have acquired a lot of skills, may in fact be misrepresented by standard measures, and the fact of the matter is that there's no earnings premium, even for the GEDs who are immigrants coming in from Mexico. So let me just sound kind of a cranky note. Let me use a little bit of water here. And sort of take, so I would just kind of ask you to take stock of what these achievement tests actually measure. How do we measure them? Why do we trust these tests as much as we do? It's a very interesting history. There's a great study of the SAT by Nicholas Lehman called The Big Test. It's a great book. It's a great book, and it talks about the history. Many people think the SAT is an IQ test. Some people think it's an achievement test. That shows the ambiguity of what these concepts are. But the question I would first ask is, what are the criteria that lead us to believe that these are valid predictors of anything? So what we're going to see, what I can summarize very briefly, is I'm going to ask the question, what do these tests predict? And how strong, how predictive are these? And so I would argue that in many ways, what these tests have been designed to predict is either other tests or grades, but not typically the performance of individuals in the workplace, which I think, in society at large, in a number of dimensions. So what I would argue is, and that there's actually a general finding that's emerged from a lot of evidence, and when you start looking across performance in the labor market, performance in society as whole, not just what tests measure in terms of freshman grades, which is what the SAT is calibrated against, or the first year in graduate school, which is what GRE is calibrated against. When you look at real performance, you find actually that these are incredibly very weak predictors. I'll give you one shred of evidence on this. But there is a general finding that goes in the way that is found in many studies, that G, this notion of cognition, is generally found to be more predictive, more powerful in tasks that are more complex. So a highly complex task, solving a mathematics problem, engaged in sort of a complex theory, G is highly predictive. But these non-cognitive traits are also highly predictive. I'll give you some snippets of this. And in particular, soft skills are particularly productive in blue-collar jobs. So there's an old finding done in American education by Sam Bowles and Herb Gentis. This is called Schooling in Capitalist America. From the title, you could guess that had some political overtones. But they found something that was quite interesting. And what they found, actually, was that in blue-collar jobs, nobody cared at all about the transcript. Nobody even cared anything. The Woody Allen quote was the right one. It was basically, did the person show up? Is the person not punching out his fellow? Grades didn't really matter. And certainly some SAT score or Iowa test score didn't matter. And so there's a general finding that these non-cognitive traits are valid across the board in a very complex tasks, which involve a lot of cognition. Obviously, cognitive tests matter. But soft skills are still quite important. So let me just give you some rough idea. Just look at the first row here. I won't go through every test. There's something posted here. So this is probably overly long, this handout, but it's designed to, so you can take home and read it if you want. But if you look, for example, at the very first line, what is the SAT? The SAT is used a lot to decide who goes to college, at least in the US. And ACT is similar. What is it validated over? What is it designed to predict? The first year in college. Grade point average. That's it. You ask, well, what does that predict? And, you know, there's a lot of change, people. And it's similar tests, that a lot of these tests are basically correlations with other intelligence tests and so forth. So there's kind of a circular quality. In fact, Tyler himself, when he was writing about these tests, said, look, we originally rate these tests because we wanted to avoid the subjectivity of grades. But we ended up calibrating all these on grades. So did we actually do anything different? So there's an issue there. So the question then becomes, and this is a very busy table, I won't go over this, but you can look at something that's actually quite interesting, and I will just go back to this briefly. I won't go back to this, but I'll talk about some aspects. If you ask, and this is from some studies we've done recently, and ask what predicts, first of all, these are correlations between something like hourly wage at age 25 and a measure of IQ, your grade point average, and your AFQT. So if you just look at the first row, look for males or look for females. Look for females. They're on the right side of the table. Either way, what you're going to find is that IQ is predictive, but it's hardly. I mean, that's the correlation. So if you're used to thinking of R squared, you square it up. And so that's like, you know, less than 2% less than 4% of the variance is going to be explained. And if you look, for example, at grade point average, at least for women, you can see that it's more predictive, which is interesting. And if you look, for example, at the AFQT, that's most predictive. I want to return to that very briefly. And it's true across a lot of other tests. So what are the validities? Are they better or worse? And so there is now, in addition to the cognitive tests, a big literature on non-cognitive tests. And so without getting into the details of personality psychology, I'll just point out that the big five domains have been developed by personality psychologists, and there's a lot of interest. They call this sometimes the longitude and the latitude of personality. I'm not that much devoted, but I will simply say there are these notions. They call it ocean because it represents openness to experience, conscientiousness, extroversion, agreeableness, and neuroticism. So there are a huge number of studies, and they have facets. And without getting into all the details, I simply say there's a large literature. But what's interesting is that many of these personality tests were developed not with just success in school, but actually for predicting how people would perform in tasks, whether it was in the Army or whether it was in jobs. So the Hogan Personality Inventory Test is a test that was developed by a personality psychologist who was exiled to the University of Tulsa. He couldn't get a job in mainstream, but what he did is he made a huge amount of money. How? Because he developed a test that was actually very helpful for employers to predict how successful people were. And so actually it's very widely used. That and this other thing called the Myers-Briggs test that was also developed by a housewife actually in the university in Pennsylvania, tried to sell it to the Educational Testing Service. They carried it for a while and they dropped it because they thought it was too soft and fuzzy. Nowadays the sales of the Myers-Briggs exceed that of the SAT because it has high predictive validity. So again, being an economist, I like to think the market test has some value, and the market test in this case has been shown. So there are a lot of these traits. So let's look very briefly at how predictive they are, even of the very things that the SAT was designed to predict. So for example, some recent studies have been made. So I just go through this very first row here. And there's some work by this study in 2005 that was looking again at a measure of a college grade point average. And what you saw was that conscientiousness, which is one of those traits, kind of self-explanatory what it means, staying on task, being focused, directing your attention, that actually has a higher correlation with this very same metric with which the SAT was measured. And if you look at all of these measures, a lot of tests, it's not just one study, but there are many studies that are actually showing that this one trait, conscientiousness, the very same trait that Jensen talked about and that many personality psychologists focus on, is even more predictive than the SAT, which is an interesting thing. And so again, you look at these tests. So for example, this is the years of schooling attained. Conscientiousness, a personality trait, is actually more predictive than crystallized intelligence as measured by a so-called fluid intelligence, which is sometimes the so-called Raven's test, these so-called measures of abstract intelligence. And you get a similar finding. So intelligence is very important, but it's also true that these non-cognitive traits are very important. And this has been verified in terms of predictability across a range of behaviors. It's not just school tests, it's not just the first year in school, but it's performance in the task, performance in military, across a range of other things. And getting something which we're all concerned about, longevity. There's been studies done by epidemiologists and by cognitive science and by psychologists showing that the single greatest trait, nothing by the way predicts longevity all that well, so this is a correlation, so you can square it, so you're getting a less than 1% of the variance explained, so it's not a great success story. Even whether your father lived to be 120 isn't a good predictor, it turns out. It's a better, you predict, but it's a very small change in probability. But what you can see among all these traits, IQ is a good predictor, but conscientiousness, which is the third trait, C, is actually a better predictor. So again, these traits matter. So this is, again, the same format. This is from Sergio, and this is literally the same framework we talked about. When you look at wages, when you look at a number of different outcomes in the labor market, you find that when you go from the bottom to the top of the distribution, you're getting basically almost, you're getting a huge increase in wages, like almost a doubling of the wages. When you go from the bottom of the distribution, this is a scale, this is a three-dimensional plot, very colorful as you can see. This is the highest level of wages. These are in exponential, these are log base E. And so you're getting a very dramatic gain from 2 to 3 in logs. And you can see that conscientiousness or non-cognitive traits and cognitive traits, these are the non-cognitive traits, these are the cognitive traits, are there, they interact, and they predict log wages. And they're both strongly predictive. And if you look at the marginal distribution, changing one, going from the bottom to the top, they're equally predictive. And I can go through a whole range of things, I won't bore you, but you can understand the format. So it's whether you're in jail, whether you're a four-year college graduate, conscientiousness, these measures of personality traits are as predictive. Going to jail, a teenage pregnancy, smoking, and so forth and so on. Now, I don't know how much time I have. Probably not so much time. A few more minutes. Okay.
Go ahead.
Go. I won't spend too much more time. But I want to tell you that this is more than just a notion of what a set of correlations is, because there is a way that you can actually change these traits and intervene. But I want to make an observation which I think is interesting, and it's consistent, actually, with several studies that have already been reported. I didn't anticipate this, but I'm happy that it does. And namely, that the achievement tests themselves are partly explained by personality tests. You are more or less showing that, grades and some sort of rating. And in fact, there's a huge amount of confusion, I would argue, that's out there. People think, well, IQ is this fixed trait. But actually, we know that we can change IQ. And in fact, some of the early interventions have shown that even on stable measures of IQ, you can actually change IQ, maybe not past a certain age, it gets to be more difficult, but there are still some changes. But for example, one very prominent study was a study by Herrnstein on the bell curve, Herrnstein and Murray on the bell curve. And this received a lot of attention, a lot of attacks. It became very widely addressed. And they used this AFQT test that I used a minute ago as a measure of IQ. In fact, I was at a seminar in Chicago in the Committee on Education just last week where somebody was making exactly that same equation. And I think that's a huge confusion. And I would argue that these achievement tests bundle IQ and personality. And so what actually Herrnstein and Murray, when they showed that IQ, or the AFQT, was predictive of behavior, they were showing both personality traits and cognition were predictive. So they were confusing the item. Remember, their story was that the IQ was something that was very powerfully predicted, and IQ was genetically determined, and therefore we had this stratification in society, and because everything was genetically determined, there was nothing we could do about inequality in American society. And what we've come to learn is no, IQ itself can be changed, but also that personality can be changed. And in fact, let me just show you one example. So this is the same AFQT measure that Herrnstein and Murray used. So actually, if you look at the measure and you say, what is AFQT consisting of, then we can actually break it down. And we can say, well, the R squared, now this is the R squared, not the R, so the percent of variance explained in the AFQT by IQ, alone is about overall groups is about 51%, about half of the variance is explained. If you look at just personality traits alone, it's about 0.35. If you put the two together, 0.57. So with these measures of IQ and these measures, actually they're highly correlated, and it's true for the other groups. So IQ or AFQT, the very achievement test, is a bundle of both of these traits coming together. And here I'll give you an example of how we should be very careful about test scores. IQ is sometimes viewed as the benchmark of all testing, sort of that's hard stuff. Now we're not going to measure schools by IQ tests because that's a trait, even though I just told you you can measure it. But even IQ itself is very easily manipulated by incentives and by situations and by personality traits, it turns out. So there's a series of studies initiated by Ed Ziegler, actually, but I'm giving you one of the more dramatic studies, where Edlund, a psychologist writing in more than almost 40 years ago, basically was looking at students. All of these were low SES students, mostly predominantly minority students. And basically, what they did was essentially measure the benchmark in this group. They randomly sampled the strata, and they found the standard result, which is like one standard deviation difference between blacks and whites, between minorities and majorities. Then they said to the minorities, okay, we'll give you one M&M, a candy, for each correct IQ answer. That was it. That's all. They were able to actually raise the test score by 12 points, which is like 80% of the black-white gap. And now what's interesting is this experiment was actually refined, and it turned out who was most responsive. It was those children who were less conscientious. The students who came in with high levels of conscientiousness are already working 100%. But the students who weren't motivated, who didn't have these kinds of internal values, could be motivated. So incentives matter, but actually the conscientiousness matter. So incentives operate, and I could go on about pay for grades, which I don't really believe in, but that's another story. So I don't know. There are some real costs, but let me just talk very briefly about, and I will talk briefly, I promise. I always say that and then keep going, but... But I will say that this is a piece of warning which I think is important for social policy. And so when I look specifically at the GED, which I have, so I'm coming back now to GED, I think there's a wider lesson here. The GED conceals and creates, I think, major problems in American social policy. So I've already told you what the GEDs look like. But what it turns out is that in American public policy, we count the GEDs as ordinary high school graduates. And so we say, look, the majority high school achievement gap is actually being remedied because we're getting more high school graduates. But when we take the GEDs out of that statistic, we find actually that the high school attainment rate for blacks in 2000, census 2000, we didn't get the data for 2010, that's every 10 years, we actually find that it's the same rate 2000 as it is in 1960. No change whatsoever. Again, all the growth came because of GDs. Now you say, okay, so what does that lead to? Well, that's part of the reason why you had this slowdown in American education. And it's also the case that that it conceals problems. So for example, it turns out that a major producer of GDs in the last 20 or 30 years has been American prisons. And that's part of the reason why we've reduced the gap. Many American prisons have taken prisoners, and required them as part of their parole, as part of their certification, to take the GED or some other educational certification. Blacks are differentially incarcerated. So there's been a huge growth, especially among black males, which help, eliminate the gap and produce a credential which has been examined, experimentally studied, and which there's very little evidence it has any effect. So there's no progress. And then there would be another aspect of the GED testing program, and that is precisely because we've introduced accountability, testing in another part of the system. Many schools now are worried about their performance. So what's the natural overflow valve? If you have a bad student, you can take that student out of the No Child Left Behind accountability by enrolling that student in a GED program. The GEDs don't count towards the No Child Left Behind compliance, but they do count, they don't count negatively. Which they probably, and they would count negatively as high school dropouts. And so what happens is you can essentially then disguise very large social problems. So one perspective, and this is a perspective I worked on, I'm working on it with Sergio, is when we evaluate a program like the GED or any other social program, we don't want to look at this as a yes, no, black, white saying, yes, this program either works or doesn't work. And this actually goes back to the very elements of what constitutes success and failure. So the question is, the GED is not a universal failure, nor is it a universal success. It benefits some, but who are those people? So in some joint work with Sergio, what we found is, yes, there were some people. The GEDs were these individuals who were high in cognitive skills, low in non-cognitive skills. But there were some very high non-cognitive GEDs. And so without getting into details and showing you graphs, the GED does create an option. You know, America, the U.S. believes very strongly in second chances. So we give people the GED. We give them the option to go on. Okay. It turns out that only, so 60% of the GEDs who certify go on to try college. What percentage of them actually finish four-year college? About 4%. So the failure rate is enormous. It's the same personality trait that's actually carried with them. But there are some people who benefit, and there is an option value. So if you're borrowing a terminology from finance, literally it's a computation of an option value, but what you find is that those levels who have, those people who have a high level of cognitive and non-cognitive skills actually benefit substantially. So the option value from taking the GED is about $20,000-$25,000. So this is a graph. The only thing you really need to see is this bar out here, this white bar, is showing you get huge returns. And those huge returns are concentrated with people who happen to be high school dropouts, but who also possess high levels of non-cognitive and cognitive skills. So it is a second chance. Bill Cosby, famous comedian, is a GED, the founder of Burger King. I don't know if you have Burger King in Chile, but there are a lot of famous GEDs, but there are a lot of people who aren't so famous, and so forth. So, but the larger approach, which is just, I'm just giving you a sample of, is our approach to policy evaluation at Chicago is more than doing just kind of looking at a mean treatment effect and saying this works or doesn't work. We can actually look at where in the distribution. So here you can see some very large benefits for certain people, and you can target the interventions, and for others there's no gain whatsoever. But then there's a question. So some people gain, some people lose. It costs about $100. You can keep taking the test. So what's the problem? It kind of deceives us, but we adjust the statistics. That's not an issue. So we do an aggregate cost-benefit study and say, is there any harm that comes from it, other than deceiving ourselves that we're doing better than we actually are? And what I want to argue is, yes, there is some deception. First of all, I already mentioned that some people were now who were subject to high-stakes testing, took the GEDs, and basically dropped out of school. So just to give you some idea, and I'll go through this, there's an adverse consequence of this. So here's a simulation, again, from some work with Sergio, where we actually ask, what's the effect of reducing the GED? So suppose you take the GED out. This is an econometric model now. I am an econometrician, after all. I'll show you one, but no equations here. But these are generated all from equations. So what we do is we say, here's the society with the GED. Here's the society without GED. This is the kind of counterfactual world you can do from econometric models. And there's some quasi-experimental evidence that supports it. So we see that with the GED, we basically have something like 25% of the people would be attending college, and that four-year college, and without the GED, the college going rate would go up. Now we ask, well, without the GED, what would the high school dropout, with the GED, the high school dropout rate is 12%, because some of these dropouts become GEDs, and that would increase to 14%, because these are counted as all honest. But the high school graduation rate jumps from about 32% to 34%. And what's interesting from this econometric model is you get very similar results from a natural experiment that was introduced in California. California was the last state to introduce the GED, and you get very comparable results from the California data when the GED, about the rise, the increase in the high school dropout rate when California introduced it. So the GED obscures the returns to education and so forth. So let me just conclude with a positive note. What I want to argue is these non-cognitive skills are important. They cause us to pause when we think about educational accountability systems. Mann himself and others were talking about the fact that we can improve these skills. But we can foster these traits. And in fact, these traits are very important. So what we've learned is that these gaps in both cognitive and non-cognitive skills open up very early across social and economic groups. So here's one example of many graphs that I could show. This is some work that Gene Brooks-Gahn, a very influential child psychologist, has done with some others. And what we see here, Greg Duncan, and what we see is that for achievement tests now, we can actually see that the gaps that are there at age 18 that are highly predictive of who goes to college or not, but not totally predictive, the gaps that are there across different socioeconomic groups are more or less there at age 5, and they're there really at age 3, which is about the earliest age you can measure this reliably. So that's important. And if you look also at gaps in non-cognitive skills, you find similar your emergence of these gaps. So what we've understood is that family investments and early childhood programs can actually promote both cognitive and non-cognitive skills. We've come to understand that there's a dynamics in which these skills are formed. IQ becomes relatively rank stable by the early teenage years, but personality traits, it turns out, are more malleable. And that's actually associated with some results in neuroscience. We actually can see that actually the prefrontal cortex and various other aspects of emotional regulation, what psychologists would call various aspects of executive functioning, can actually be fostered into very early ages. And we have a lot of interventions. Schools foster these traits. And so this will show you something you may have never seen before. These are what I would swear, and we could talk about that if there's any interest, about causal effects of an additional year of schooling on measures of components of this achievement test I was talking to you about earlier. So word knowledge and a bunch of other things. But also, if you go from high school, graduate high school, from less than 12 years of school to graduate, and I say these are causal effects, and I can defend that claim, you can see that there are substantial growths in various measures of socio-emotional skills that actually are associated with attending school. So schools are fostering these traits. Even though we're not typically measuring them, they are fostering these traits. And this same PERI program that Sergio was mentioning, I'll just tell you briefly, this is a program, it was an early childhood program. And what was interesting about this is that this program, when it was originally introduced during the war on poverty, during the time of the Johnson administration, was intended to try to measure and to promote the skills of disadvantaged people. These were all inner city, well, disadvantaged African-American children. And what happened was that in the late 60s, an evaluation of this program was undertaken. And in the late 1960s, what was the thinking? That IQ was the essential measure, or some measure of cognition was the essential measure. So if you look at what happened here, this is something that's found in many of these programs, that when the kids were enrolled into entry, you'll notice that the IQ at entry was actually at 80. So it was a subnormal IQ population. There was a surge when people were given these intensive enriched interventions. The treatment group had a huge surge, but by age 10, the IQs reverted more or less to the mean of their population, so it was a subnormal population, was selected to be subnormal, but there was no difference between treatment and control. Using the measure of evaluation that was put in place, this program was pronounced a failure. Yet, when we look at this, when we look at studies of this, we have these people followed, an experimental evaluation, These people are now in their 50s. They were followed for 40 years on long-term earnings histories. We can look at the difference between experiments and controls. What we can actually see is that a rate of return to this, the actual annual rate of return per dollar, is of the order of magnitude of 6 to 10% a year. That reflects some uncertainty because there's some aspects of non-market benefits, valuing crime, the value of lost life. But even in the most adverse case, it's about 6% and statistically significant. And that compares very favorably with the return on the stock market between 1945 and 2008, which is about 5.8%. So the point is that social policy said this program was a failure, at least in the late 1960s. Why? Because it looked only at the test score. And that's why I think that looking at this is a serious issue. So this is an example. What did Perry do? It raised social and emotional skills. And it even affected the achievement tests. So at age 14, even though these kids are no smarter who are in the treatment group, they have higher achievement test scores. Why? What does it take to get a higher achievement test score? Not only your raw ability, but your desire to learn, your desire to be motivated. And that's exactly, and so you can see these measures. So let me just say that most of the treatment effect from Perry comes from these non-cognitive skills. So let me just say that the following lessons emerge. So it's not just a story of determinism. It's not a negative story. What we've learned from this investment is that we can manipulate this. This is a new margin of social policy. Investment is most productive in the early years for IQ and for fluid intelligence. That can also be changed. Later years, later investments are still productive. And so if we have a policy in asking where should we invest in the life of the child, it turns out that it's very productive to invest, for example, in social and emotional skills. That's only now recently becoming recognized in American social policy. So there are now a lot of studies of character education, and there's a basis for it. So I'll just show you one example of the kind of study that we're doing. This is a study that actually says, suppose we have two different goals. One is to try to maximize total education in American society, and the other is to reduce crime. It turns out that crime and education depend in differential degrees on these cognitive skills and these non-cognitive skills. Crime is heavily loaded on non-cognitive skills. It turns out social control, aggression, and so forth. There's more scope for malleability. Early years are very important, and the early years play a very important role in a sense of motivating children to acquire the cognitive skills. So there's no sense that early years aren't important. But two things to notice in this graph. First, there's a distribution about what optimal investments would be. So we solve this model, we look at it. And what you can see is, if you ask where is it important to invest, relatively more in the early years or the late years, say before age 8, after age 8, say just roughly, what you find is that if your goal is to maximize education, educational attainment, it's more important to invest relatively more in the early years, because cognition is typically very rank stable after about age 10. If your goal is to minimize crime in society, there's greater leverage. And you can actually then say that, well, there's still an advantage because more motivated children are going to learn more from school and they're going to be more school ready and so forth. But the structure is going to be that there's going to be less of a bias towards investing in the early years. You can spread it more evenly. And it also means that second chances for kids who are growing up in disadvantaged environments. You have a lot of adolescents who are essentially in serious environments and have been bypassed in the early years, that these non-cognitive traits, these personality traits, are a margin. But the other thing to notice is that there's a distribution. And that distribution reflects the differential advantage, not only of the child, but also of the parents. And so there's a long story that goes into that. So let me just conclude. I would argue, with all due respect to everybody, that the focus on cognitive traits alone can be very deceptive. And I think that we also should understand that these soft skills matter. They can be shaped, that they are another avenue for social policy, and that improving them is a productive avenue of good social policy. So I like this GED simply because it gives you this very sharp crystallization. It's not that I'm fascinated by, or although I am, the GED alone, but it's a very nice bifurcation. You rarely get this kind of thing where people are so strong in one trait and so weak in the other, and actually you can look at their differential performance. So the GED is only testing part of it, and it conceals problems, and there's a larger lesson to take. We have this broader inventory. And if we look at what Ralph Tyler was saying, and even if we look, for example, at what Horace Mann was saying, we do have other measures. So it's not that we're handicapped. And I think when we think about educational policy, we might want to think more inclusively, as every creator of a modern test has thought about, these softer skills, these other dimensions of human performance. So I will conclude with that, and thank you for your patience.